for women in America, white, black, Latino, anything, you're supposed to be skinny, not eat, or if you do eat, it's supposed to be salads, drink water, you're supposed to wear high heels and tight clothing, you're supposed to have big boobs, you know, I mean, it's just, you have this social image that you're supposed to be like a model, I guess, or whatever, you know, I mean, there's this image that girls are taught growing up, this is how you're supposed to be in order to get anywhere in life. You gotta be pretty to get a husband to be successful in your life. That's not so much what I was taught, but what I picked up on.
Tyler says, if I may, what are some of the things in white families that white families kind of teach their children as white kids growing up in the United States, growing up in this country, to expect this or to have this or to do this?
Well, expectations has always been jobs. You know, if you're not going to do some type of outdoor recreation, you know, say you're not going to play sports, mm-hmm. get a job. Okay. That's how I was raised. Be able to support yourself any way you can. Even though we were well off, my family, not well off, I say upper middle class.
Okay.
So, of course, I got a car on my 16th birthday as well, but it was just a little Acura, so it was so much fun. It was an amazing car. But we got a great deal on it, but we'll go on that detail later. But it was just, you work for whatever you want, and that's what I was raised to. If you want a car, you're going to work to get that car, in which I did. I worked a bunch of summer jobs. Even though I didn't make enough money for it, I showed a dedication towards some kind of responsibility to get that. So it was just, that's pretty much where, I can't get it out right now. I'm starting to stumble on my words. But yeah, whatever I want, you work to get it. You don't ask someone else for it unless, you know, birthdays or something like that. You always go for what you want.
I noticed this trend here amongst all of you all is that success, fight for the best or do better than that person is sitting next to you, regardless of their color. I noticed that these expectations for within the communities of whites, culturally and socially speaking, they seem to be, even within the white community itself, it seems that your parents or your communities as a whole are expecting you to be this way because of the color of your skin. Is this, am I saying this correctly? No, am I way off base here?
I wouldn't say cause the color of the skin.
Is this just something that is expected amongst the white community to be successful?
I think it was just expected because the Great Depression, my grandparents went through it, my great-great-grandparents went through it, and that tradition still continued into my family about saving money, put it in the right places, don't just waste it. So even that going into this point, you know, it did affect me and my family. But that wasn't just for the white community. I think that also affected the black community. But somehow or another, I think those lessons were instilled more in the white community than other
communities. Yes. Jason A. Sumner?
Well, before I have to go, I'll make this last point. I don't look at it so much as being the white community or the whole. For me, it's more of a family thing.
Mm-hmm.
My mom and dad had to sacrifice to give me and my brother opportunities that were never afforded them. So I don't compete with others. I never look at it this way. And I'm always trying to strive for the best for myself. And it really, regardless of who's around me or whatever's around me, I want better for my future, for my future family. And that's been instilled in me. I was always taught, do unto others as you have done unto you. I was always taught not to judge other people because they're going to judge you in return. And you will be judged and, you know, treated the way you treat others. I was also taught that you be respectful to others, you be polite, and you uphold the culture that you're a part of. And in this case, I am a Southern gentleman. In every aspect of the word, I do believe you show respect to others. It's part of that, I guess, chivalry. I know we always hear that chivalry is dead in the South. I don't believe that. I think it is proper and appropriate that you do open the door for a lady. Now, in today's culture, that's not, you know, my fiance doesn't expect that of me. And a lot of people, it's more, we're equals, so there's an independence about everyone. So that doesn't always apply, but I do still carry with me that that notion that I need to advance myself and work hard to get to where I want to be. You see what I'm saying?
I do.
Yeah.
A lot of what we're talking about, I can't help but notice throughout the program, we call them, you know, white issues or issues among the white community. When, I mean, really a lot of them are humanistic issues. I mean, I'm sure that every parent wants their kid to be more successful than them. Yes, it's probably more prevalent, you know, whatever, in the white community. But, you know, I've seen much greater classism in the black community than I have in the, you know, the white against the black community. I mean, I've seen black people be 1,000 times meaner to other black people than white people. So what we're talking about, we blend all of these things into this white frame, but they're mostly just humanistic views.
Andrew Newsom?
Now, ironically enough, I think, my parents taught me in an almost a colorblind way, but in a way not so. They taught me not to expect anything special or different out of other races or other people in general, just to expect the same attitude that I showed. But then they also taught me what other races might expect of me. They did their best to teach me, this is what happened in the past, and because of this past, because of this history, this is what the African American community, or this is what the Asian community or Latino community might expect you to think. And I thank my dad, I thank my mom, because I feel like they did a good job preparing me for some of these ideas before I came in real contact with them and before I you know, was blindsided.
Megan Carraway?
Like I said, I grew up in a prominent family, and my parents always strived to give me what they didn't have growing up. You know, both of my parents, their parents struggled growing up, and my mom and dad both had to work really hard to get where we are today. And I have had the advantage of, you know, getting a car on my 16th birthday, getting a computer, getting, you know, things that some children don't get at all from their parents. They have to work very hard to get it. And because of that, I think it's made me almost a weaker person. I never had to work to get a car. I asked for it for my 16th birthday, and I just got it. I got a computer because we moved, and my dad felt bad for moving, pulling me out of school. I almost feel like I'm disadvantaged in a way because my parents tried to give me the best, that they almost ruined me in a way. I can't help but help people. That's the type of person I am, no matter who you are, where you come from, what you look like. I gave a friend of mine, well, not really a friend of mine anymore, but I gave her a lot of money, and she said she was going to pay it back, and she never did. And I've been run over quite frequently because I've been taught to help others. You know, my parents always gave me what I wanted because we could, and I guess that set it up in my mind that I can do the same for others. And I think it's put me at a disadvantage because now I don't really know how to control it, almost, you know, and it puts me at a disadvantage towards a lot of things in life.
Do you think you were that is something indicative of the white community?
Yeah, I think especially families that are that come from, you know, they grow, you know, the parents grow up in a harsher community. They give too much to the children. Today, I think that children are either brought up to be successful. You got to do this to get this. You got to do that. Like, Tyler was saying earlier. I'm sorry.
Let me ask you all this. What if you're poor and white? How are you viewed, or you're lower income and white? How are you viewed throughout your... How are you viewed from your white constituents, or how are you viewed in general as a whole throughout the white community?
Most of the white people that I know are poor.
Mm-hmm.
They're either are poor, like me, I am on food stamps,
mm-hmm.
Or they are rich. They live in a nice house. They have a nice suburb, you know, whatever, but they're $130,000 in debt. So technically they are broke, you know. There's not a
poor. It's called being poor with a mask on.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think that there's anything, at least that I see culturally, against poor people. You know, like I said, I see it 1,000 times more in, you know, well-educated, well-spoken black Americans speaking down about young, poor black Americans. I hear that 1,000 times more than I hear rich white Americans talking down about poor white Americans, most of the time, unless they're talking about, you know, some Discovery Channel show or something, you know what I mean? Swamp people or, you know, that kind of stuff. Extreme lower class.
It is 29.
No, I mean, yeah. I don't mean lower class in just a disrespectful way.
It is 29 minutes past the hour here on 91.9 FM WLJS. When we come back, I want to kind of expound on what we discussed earlier. I want to know, as a community, as Caucasians, white, whichever way you want to put it, what can the white community, if there is anything that can be done at all to heal from America's past, rectify, if you will, and there are many times where nothing can be done, but if there is something that can be done, that is what I want to know. And I think that is what all of our audience members, our listeners out there would like to know. If there can be anything done on behalf of the white community to, as some people say, fix what has happened in the past.
Don't be racist. The number one thing.
Okay.
Just don't be racist.
Okay. All right. Well, we're going to get into that when we come back from the commercial break. It is 30 minutes past the hour. We'll be right back.
Stand for holiness.
Stand for holiness.